Okay, so let's take a closer look at the circuit board. I've gone and dug out as many data sheets as I can. I think I've got the correct information, but of course, if I make any mistakes or anyone spots something that I missed, then certainly highlight it in the comments below. But basically, what we've got is the control board with input and output, and then the main power coming in. So if we have a look on this side, there's a black wire over here and a white one. That's the live and neutral mains coming into this transformer over here. We've got a relay. This side of the board over here is the high power AC side of the board. And then this kind of quadrant of the board, or this little triangle over here, is where all the electronics and the main electronic IO brain part is. In the middle of the board, we've got some isolation, so we're going to talk about that in a moment. This connector over here is all the switches from the front of the unit. So you've got a couple of switches and then LEDs which will highlight or blink in them. So that is the switch control, and that is all coming through to this PIC microprocessor over here. Now going back to the power side, so we've got the mains coming in, we've got a transformer which is going to step the voltage down, but we've still got AC. So over here we've got a bank of diodes. This is a bridge rectifier, so that's going to rectify the AC to DC, the step down voltage, and then some filtering which is going to drive the low current or electronic side of the circuit. Up over here we've got an ST Micro Triac, and if I've read it correctly, that is ST T435 series triac. So what is a triac? A triac in its basic form is a solid state switch. So a transistor in electronics would be used for switching, let's say, low current DC, whereas triacs are used for switching potentially high power AC. They are bi-directional. So here on this board, we can see it's actually got three inputs. So the one is clipped off, but it's still operational. This pin over here is the gate, so a low voltage or current will activate or allow this to conduct through this pin over here and then the backplane. So the backplane, which is soldered to the board, that will act as the bidirectional path for AC. And this can only switch AC. If you try and pass DC through it when it's activated, even if you remove the activation from the gate, it'll stay switched on. So it can only control AC. Now this can act as a kind of on-off switch, or it can be switched at high speed to control things. So these are used typically for controlling the speed of motors or dimming lights. So in this case, this one is controlled. So it's getting its control through this opto-isolator from the electronic side up here. And this is controlling this wire over here. Now this brown wire is going to the main water pump. So that's this brown wire is coming around here, and this is the main water pump, which is AC. So that's why they're controlling it with that triac. Then next to it, we've got another triac, and I think this is also another ST Micro. I think it's a T1635T8i. And I'll have all the data sheets. If you want to read more about these, I'll put links below. This triac is another one. It's a little different. This one is called a snubberless triac. Now, snubberless is a trademark name by ST Micro, and I'll just read to you what the snubberless actually means. But this one can handle 16 amp of AC. And snubberless triacs are particularly suited in three quadrant and inductive load designs with enhanced switch off capability. So they can handle a reverse voltage of up to 800 volts and a maximum of up to 40 amps. Now, this one isn't rated for 40 amps, this is a 16 amp one. In terms of the three quadrants, as I believe, you can operate things with either positive or negative voltage and current. And you can either have positive voltage, positive current, positive voltage, negative current. And if you have a draw quadrant in terms of where voltage is positive and where current is negative or positive, you've got four quadrants. But this can operate in three of those quadrants. So that's what their trademark snubberless is. So this one is connected to this output over here, and this wire is going up and controlling the boiler. So this is the switch to run the water pump. This one runs the actual boiler. So we're going to come back to the other I/O controls. I think I've worked out what the thermostat is on the actual top here, because we've got the wire coming up, it goes through a thermostat, and then obviously returns, but that's powering the boiler. So now we get to these two fellows over here. So these are interesting. These are made by Motorola, and they are these ones are the MOC3023s. And their full name is a random phase opto-isolator triac driver output. So what do these do? So if we look at the circuit, as noted, this side of the board is the AC and kind of higher power side, and then we've got the electronic side over here. This side, in terms of if we think of like the workers on this side, this is high power and noisy on this side, and the workers on this side are more quiet, and they don't want to be disturbed, but yet they still need to communicate with each other. So what we have is a means of these sides talking to each other, but trying to isolate the noise, particularly from this AC high-powered side. So these are opto-isolators, and inside there's actually infrared LEDs. So as opposed to any direct electrical connection between the two sides here, the signal is done via optics, by literally an infrared LED internal to these. So these, you can see there is a connection to the gate. So the controlling pin to switch on the triac on both of these, there's the control over there. So the signal will come from this side of the electronics, go through here, have the optical isolation through these two guys through to the power side to switch on or off these triacs in terms of switching on either the pump or the boiler. This little fellow over here is merely a voltage regulator. I think it's a 3M317. So it's a three-terminal adjustable voltage regulator. And if I've got it correct, it can be adjusted from 1.2 to 37 volts. And then the main brain controlling everything on the board is this PIC microcontroller over here. So this PIC microcontroller comes from the PIC18F family. And these are specifically there to control things like do pulse width modulation control for motors and the like. So this will be, it's got a, I think it's an 8-bit CPU inside, and it apparently it runs up to 12 MIPS. And this will have the code and the logic, which is going to read the input that it gets and then controls the output. So if we have a look, we've got the switches over here, which are coming through as one part of the input. And then we've got all these plugs. So if we go through these various connectors which are coming in, this first one is a connector where there's a switch to the draw. So on the front of the device, you saw when I tried to test it earlier, it didn't work because I didn't have the one little draw slid in. You can put in little drawers in the front for whether you're doing coffee or tea or you just want water, and there's a switch. So that's one of the inputs. If that switch isn't switched, then the microcontroller is going to say, no, I'm not going to operate. The next bit of input, this is the thermocouple. So this is the temperature sensor, which is going into the boiler. So that is going to keep an eye on the temperature. So that's another piece of input. And from that input, this is going to control when it's switching on or off the boiler. So the boiler, for one razor, when you want to brew, it'll ensure that the boiler is at a certain temperature range. If you don't use this for a while, it'll constantly monitor that. And for a certain period of time, it's going to maintain the temperature within a certain range so that it can boil up to the optimum temperature quickly. If it's been left for, I think it's like six, I forget the duration, but if you've left this for a long time overnight or what have you, it'll then let the temperature sink right down and almost go into an off standby mode. And then it's obviously going to take the longest to boil. But it's so that it's not sitting there boiling away. If you go away on vacation, you don't have a power off switch, this will automatically just power itself down and not boil. But if you're actively using this during the day, so within a, let's say, a 2-hour window, it'll maintain the temperature so you can almost get an instant brew. So I think on the top of the unit, over here where we've got the thermostat switch at the top over here, which I showed you earlier, I think that's a fail safe. So if for any reason this logic wasn't working and died, and there was still AC current going to the boiler, eventually it would trigger this thermostat and switch it off so that it wouldn't potentially explode. The next little connector over here with the white wires, if you look carefully, it says water. This is going to this little reservoir over here. So you fill up the tank, and over here, this is the bottom of the reservoir. It's obviously got a little water sensor switch. If you happen to push the brew switch and you haven't filled this with water, it'll kind of click on and off because it senses that there's no water. So remember, what it does, it's going to look for new water. It's going to brew with existing hot water in the tank, but it wants you to replenish. So you need to put water in here, which is going to draw through. It's going to use the already hot water, but it needs to replenish with water that you put in here. But it won't start that process unless it senses that you've got water in there. And that's the input coming in through that connector. The yellow set of ones, you'll remember that solenoid valve earlier, which I said at control, it can click on. There was that Y connector and that solenoid valve, which I think allowed the water to, when the pump was going to be pushed through the boiler, that controls the solenoid valve. So that's the one bit of output. So far, all of these have been input. That's one bit of output, which is switched. And then the other connector over there is the little baby that we changed. So had I received a new little air pump, I'm not quite sure if you can see over there, you should, it actually says air pump. So that's the air purge pump. So that is the connector to drive that air purge pump. And to tell you the truth, I don't fully understand the role of that. It's obviously got to purge or remove air, but I'm not quite sure why, how it's removing air, presumably from, you don't want air going into the pipes and into the boiler. I presume it's actually purging air from that. So that is what drives that. And then this little header over here, these pins, which are labeled, the one's labeled test, and you can see one of them is bent. This will be, I presume, the communication to this. So this can speak I2C, CAN, and USB, if I recall correctly. And this will be the interface to that to program the code or the running code which controls the operation of the whole unit. So that's the workings of the device. And I must say, fairly straightforward. It would be interesting to actually see the code and to understand the actual logic in terms of when it's switching and what have you. So for the most part, again, it's just surprising. I mean, the internals of this seem to be reasonably well put together. This is one of the highest rated little single serve coffee makers. It does coffee, tea, or what have you. It seems to be nicely built. It's got a nice simple control, well put together. It's just a shame that things like this will fail and potentially be thrown away for one cheap $10, $13, $15 little pump. It's a pity they don't have little better pumps. I might, if this one fails again, I'm going to have a backup, but I might try and investigate to see whether there are better options, better little air pumps which have got a far better meantime before failure. I mean, the duty cycle of that pump is not high. It only comes on when you're actually brewing and when it's pumping the water into your brew. It's not like a fish tank pump, let's say, which has got a constant duty cycle. So I'll say that flummoxes me somewhat. Right, we're all ready for our first test. I've gone and put some water in the reservoir at the top. I've got a rubber mallet so this doesn't overbalance this way. I've got it back in the tray in case we get some water spilling. There we go, the relay is switched. If you can see, the light is now green. So, the one thing I should have done before I even strapped this in was at least check it, because it's a particularly used little air purge pump, was powered up with 12 volts. So, of course, I'll be really annoyed if this thing doesn't function properly, and that's my own fault. I should have double-checked it before I put it in there. But nonetheless, we're ready to go. I'm going to bring you in closer. Right, so I'll bring you to the attention. We want to see that this is going to operate, that no water is going to come down this pump, because this should be pumping air up there. And then the other point where there was a very slight leak was that the temperature sensor over here, which I've obviously got, I've tightened up the clamp, I've got the zip tie, and it was dripping down here on the boiler. So we just want to make sure there's no water there and certainly no leaking, and this is operating. Uh-oh. There's water that's come down this line to the air purge pump. I just want to see when this operates. I can't see any leaking from the temperature probe at all at this point. I just want to see when this is going to come into operation. assume it must be normal then that this water comes down here. He says. So that noise is the pump below, which is pumping out the brew. So I'll just bring you down here. That's that pump. Okay, the pump's gone off. Oh, there we go, the air purge. Ah, so that was the air purge doing that last little blow at the end of the brew. So it looks like that's normal operation. There's no water leaking out underneath it at the bottom. What I'm going to do is there we go. So it's done a little preheat. I'm going to go get another flask of cold water, put it in here, and we'll see then how quickly the operation goes through, just to make sure we've got no leaks.
So here we go. It's about a minute later. I've just got a cold jug of water, which I'm putting in. And this is the beauty of this device, which is why I really like this coffee maker. Coffee and tea. I enjoy both coffee and tea. And the beauty is that during the day, I can come up to this, and when it's within that certain time period, you get an instant brew. You're not waiting for the kettle to heat up because it's keeping that kettle hot. So there we go. We're all on. I'm going to double check things again. So I'll bring you in a little closer. The LED is already green because the boiler's up to temperature. I'm going to switch the other switch, which does a pulsed brew. So there's a switch below. If I switch that, you see that goes red. That does a pulsed, a slower brew to push the water through a little slower in pulses, which gives you a warmer cup and a stronger brew, which is quite nice. So we're going to try that function. DC pump's not operating yet. I assume that's going to kick in at the end when it does the final kick out at the end of the brew. So you see it stops, it waits, and then it continues with the brew as opposed to like constantly doing it. Keeps on heating the water to maintain a good temperature. No leaks so far. Oh, I lie. Look there. There's water. I can see there's water dripping out. Now, Isaac, that is going through the motor. Bugger. Now, I suspect that this second-hand motor is already broken. It must be. It's not coming out the top. So this is a little warning about buying these things off eBay. Okay, so let me take a closer look and we'll talk about that. So there we go. So here's a little education. It is bone dry at the top here. So nothing is coming through the top over here, which it wasn't doing previously. This existing zip tie that was on you is holding tight enough so that no fluid is coming through here. It is seeping out. There's this little hole right, you can see that little gap over there. So it's obviously passing through this membrane, which is obviously torn again, or not torn again. I was sitting wondering, how can so many people, because it's noted that some of these are saying they're coming, these are being pulled out of existing Keurig coffee makers. Well, why are these being pulled out? Because these people are obviously going and finding or buying up coffee makers which are being thrown out, because the one key part which is failing are these little air purge pumps. So they're pulling out these air purge pumps, not even checking them to see that this is the actual failed part, and then selling them on eBay. Yeah, it did say used, but it's supposed to be working used, but quite clearly it's not. So buyer beware, there's a little lesson. Hopefully the one that comes from the new one that I bought is a new one. We'll yet to see that, because I haven't yet come across a place where you can buy these brand new from a shop. I'm sure if I go to Alibaba or somewhere like that, I might find them. What I'll do, let me unzip this, open it up, and let's see if we can see where the fault lies inside that. So here we go. I've gone and clipped off the zip ties. Just a warning, if you are doing this yourself, be very careful doing this, because this boiler does say stay hot for a long time and you can get burnt rather badly. I very quickly touched my finger against this when I was trying to get it out. I didn't burn too badly, but it could be nasty. So let me undo this very carefully and we'll see whether we can see if there's an existing tear inside this used little air purge pump. As I'm undoing this, water's kind of dripping out. And as I do this, I suppose I'm getting a little bit wiser. The one thing to do, and this is a lesson for anyone else who's going through this or considering buying one of these pumps, look for a new one. Hopefully it's they're not misrepresenting themselves saying it's new and they've just pulled it out of a machine. I should have known as soon as I saw water going down that pipe that there obviously wasn't an airtight seal, I assume. If I blow in here, then before I undo it, I don't know. Okay, so I'm going to try and do a comparison with one which is supposedly working. When I suck, air comes out, and I shoot, there's obviously a valve system in here. When I blow in, it is blocked. Let's see. I part this. Okay. Oh my goodness. So I'll bring you in, if you look inside, you can look, is that coffee grinds or is it just rust? Yeah, let me show you. So here we go, this is the top end of the pump, which we'll carefully try and have a look at to see where the brake is. But this has obviously been come out of a failed machine. You can see this debris over here, which I assume, yeah, it's the screws. So we've got the DC motor, which turns this off-center point pin to do the pump action, and it's obviously been wet in a previous coffee machine so long that there is now corrosion on the screws inside. So buyer beware, don't buy a used one of these. Only, well, we'll see. Apparently the new one is one to either today or tomorrow or the next day will be delivered, so we'll wait till that arrives. Hopefully I don't have to go through the soldering exercise again and it's got a proper connector on. If it doesn't, it would suggest that it's not new. Let's just have a look at the membrane. Yeah, I can't easily see. It's obviously a very fine tear. You can quite clearly see the water on this side of it, which shouldn't be there. But there's a tear on one of these membranes. And if I pull this around too much, that's only going to exacerbate it or create a new tear, because these are so delicate. So I said, I can't spot the tear. I've carefully looked. I can hear some squelching, but that, of course, could be. It's definitely from this side. But yeah, so beware. As soon as the other one arrives, I will try and do some kind of testing to test it beforehand. But obviously, the ultimate test is putting it in here and seeing if it's actually pumping out air. But what I perhaps will do is I'll add 12 volts to it before I connect the other one and just put my finger on and make sure that it is pumping out air and that it's not going to allow water back into it. Right, next update coming soon. Okay, it's a day later. The next one has arrived. This one is supposedly new, so we're hoping it's going to have the full DC cable with a connector on it. And I can already tell it doesn't. It's been snipped off, so this is no way this is new. So there we go. That's two eBay sellers who have kind of misrepresented. Well, the one said used, but certainly not in working order. And you can see the connecting wires have just been cut off. So I'm reasonably confident it's just been pulled out of another machine. And I reckon there's a good chance that this won't work either. But I'm going to power it up. I'll see if it blows air before we put it into the coffee machine.
Okay, so I've got this hooked up to my power supply, but I'm already concerned because I've put my mouth on here and I've blown in here and I can feel a little bit of air going in here. And if this is a complete rubber membrane without any hole in it, there should be no air that's able to go in there as far as I'm concerned. But let's just check. Operates. And I can feel air being blown out, but I say I don't have confidence. I'm not going to waste time on too much more video. I'm going to solder it in, get it all set up ready for a test, and the next video I'll show you is where I actually test it to see. We'll do a couple of tests to see if it does operate or not. Right, we're already set to go again. This is the second supposedly new motor, which I think we can say isn't. I've got the camera positioned so right under here, just where the point of the screwdriver is, that is the little weep hole at the bottom of the motor. If there's going to be any leaking, it's going to come out over there. And we also want to observe this pipe to see if water starts coming down here. I think almost certainly then it's allowing air to pass in this direction. So let's go for the first run. It's filled up with water. There, it's switched on, it's blowing, it's operating. But there's definitely water in there, and I think I can see the water going down into the pump. Okay, I'm gonna go fill up again, we'll do another run. Okay, ready for run two. It's operating. Don't see any water coming out, but I'm still not confident. I'm going to give it a few runs off camera and I'll bring you back in to kind of wrap up and see if it's working properly or not. Okay, I've done a couple of runs and so far I'm not seeing any leaks. As I say, it still doesn't give me any confidence. I reckon even if this doesn't have a tear now, this is used and I reckon it could go quite soon. But I actually desperately need this coffee maker to be working for this evening. So I've got it on one last run where it does the kind of longer brew. Go for it now, let's see what happens. But whatever happens, I'm gonna have to close it up and hope for the best so I can use it tonight. And then I'm gonna try and scout around on the internet to see if I can find a new one of these little air purge pumps. See, there's water coming down that pipe. It'll kick in and run soon. There we go, it kicks in. Pushing the air out. Okay, and so far, it's not leaking. But I say, it doesn't inspire much confidence. I reckon if this doesn't have a tear now, I reckon this is probably fairly well used. But anyway, I'll put it back together and we'll wrap up. And I did not show you me taking this apart. So if you do happen to want to work on these, most of the screws are in the bottom. So you've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And under these rubber stoppers, 7, 8, 9, 10. And then you've got the ones which hold the cord once you get the base off. And then the one that caught me off guard, at the back of the unit, you can see, I know the light's not that great, just inside, there we go, you can see there's a screw there, but there was a plastic cap covering that, and it was really tightly on there. I literally, in getting it out, it got damaged, so I couldn't put it back, no loss at all. But there, tucked behind a plastic cap, there's one at the top here. But and then otherwise, the backing comes off quite easily.
Okay, so to end it off, I thought, let me actually brew a cup of coffee, because I haven't had a cup of coffee now for over a week out of this Bun My Cafe one serve coffee maker. So let's do it to make sure it actually does the full operation. So I've got a K-cup. I use Barry House. They've got a breakfast blend. This is ultimate hazelnuts that I'm trying. I've not tried it before. I've got another one as well. I'll have links down to this. As I said, this is a really impressive single serve. After getting it open, looking at the insides, barring that wonderful little air purge pump, I think it's a great little unit. These are highly rated as being very versatile in terms of being able to do just hot water, doing tea, coffee, the K-cups. And they're noted as doing the brew at a good temperature and providing really good flavor, which is why they are so highly rated, which is why I was going to be very sorry if I had to go and either try find something else or spend another $150 on a new one. So I'm glad I've rescued it, with the caveat that I think that little air purge pump is going to go again until I find a new one. There we go, that's the K-cup in. That's the tray in. I'm going to flick the switch here so that it's got the stronger brew. Just out of information, so it's got the stainless steel tray and a drip tray in the front. You can put higher mugs or small flasks underneath here as well. So it does a good size. Generally, the top brew is about 12 ounces. So I put that under there. Enough for one cup. What I'm missing, actually, with a cup this low, you can get splash out of the top. So it's got little a lifter, so I'm going to go get those so I don't get coffee splashing all over the place. Okay, so this is a little device. You can put it on there. If you've got a smaller mug, you can put the mug on top there to try and prevent some of the splash. You can also actually stack it if you've got a really small mug. So there we go, all ready to go, light green. I've got it on my bench, so I'm hoping I'm not going to get water coming out the bottom, because that's what was happening. The water was obviously flowing out of that little pump, down into the bottom of the unit, and straight out onto the counter, and that's how I realized something was going awry. Ooh. As I said, it's the first time I've had this hazelnut brew. I was just trying something a little bit different, and it does really smell nice. That is the air purge going. And then it stopped. Okay. A few minutes to, or a few ticks to drip. Now, I normally go to the sink and then rinse this out. I'll obviously do that after I'm done with the video. Oh, that's good. So that's classic. I'm really chuffed that I managed to get that back together. I know it's probably been a long video, but hopefully a little bit of insight into quite a few things. For one, how a simple little device, little simple air purge pump, can take one of these down and mean that people are throwing actually potentially really good coffee makers away just for a potential $15 to $20 air purge pump. Be very careful. Try and hunt around and find an actual new pump. Don't try it. There are so many eBay sellers out there saying don't buy a used one. And even the new ones, it looks like,
are coming out of existing machines. So unfortunately, it could be potluck, but it's still worth trying to get one and resurrecting one of these. And hopefully you gained a little bit of insight from the electronics and how it all worked. That was a nice little interesting exercise. If you gained any value from the video, please give it a thumbs up, and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.